Well, good afternoon, everyone. Welcome. I'm going to get all my excuses out of the way first. I was not out late partying. I just lost my voice for no good reason, so I'm sorry I sound like this. I'm going to power through it. Also found out I was doing this talk late last week, so I've been working hard to make sure it's a good talk for you all. But those are my excuses, and feel free to throw things at me. I'm sorry if it's bad. If it's good, you should think much more of me because of my excuses. So welcome to the session today. We're going to talk about a project called Atomic Red Team and how we use it to do adversary emulation for testing security programs. My name is Chris Rothe. I'm one of the co-founders, chief product officer at Red Canary. So my goal with this talk is to tell you first a little bit about how Red Canary as a for-profit entity thinks about open source projects. And what we do to kind of support them. Second, we'll do kind of a deep dive into Atomic Red Team. So if you're familiar, that might be a little bit of a review for you. If you haven't seen it before, hopefully it gets you excited to potentially go use it yourself or contribute to the community. And then last, we'll do a little bit to talk a little bit about the things we've done to grow that community and our general approach to when we want to put an open source project out there and really get it adopted by the community, how we do that. So that's my goal for this talk today. There's obviously a lot of reasons why companies participate in open source software. One is, you know, they want other people to write code for them, right? Turns out that doesn't work very well because poorly maintained and open source projects that don't have a great core set of maintainers tend to not do very well. Some people also do them for pure marketing purposes. Those tend to get buzz and then die off and people kind of move along. So that's not the way we think about it. Certainly there are times when, you know, our marketing team will take one of our open source projects and promote it and help us get the word out about it. But generally speaking, we don't do it for that reason. So you might ask, well, what is the reason? And if you were to find yourself on, almost, if you were to find yourself on the Red Canary website, you might find something that looks like this and tells the story of our company. And if you zoomed in a little bit on the last paragraph, what you would find is that our mission is to improve security outcomes for everyone, not just our community, not just our customers, not just people who give us money, but for the entire community. And this has kind of been our ethos. It's been there from day one, and it gives us great license to do things that are just for the community, and we don't have to go back to our CFO and say, like, oh no, we're doing this because we're gonna get this ROI, right? We can just say, throw the community trump card and say, because the community needs it, right? That only goes so far, but you can imagine it is a great license for people who wanna bring things out and give them away for free. So one of the ways that we've done that is, sorry, I skipped twice there. One of our primary mechanisms for doing that has been our blog and giving away a ton of educational content through our blog over the years to really try to help people learn and grow and progress in building their program. So for more than 5 years, we've done this, and you know, it ranges from things like how to build out an incident response program and where to start to kind of ranty, sorry, my slides are skipping on me, rants about you know, this is one of my favorites, things we should stop doing right now in order to make InfoSec better. As we've expanded and gotten more awareness on our blog, we've had opportunity to work with other contributors and bring other people in to tell their stories. You know, we don't want it to just be our voice. We want it to be really a resource that everybody can use to learn from each other. We also do really regularly do deep dives on various things that we've detected and the mechanisms for detecting them. The goal here is just to give it away and help people take it into their program if they want to go, in this case, figure out how to detect Ryuk, strategies for how to do that. So this is really one of my favorite things about our mission is that we have this license to just put all this stuff out there. It doesn't have to tie into any kind of business objective other than just us supporting the security community and helping people get better outcomes. One of the great things I love about our company. It's also cool because we have a huge team of security folks inside of Red Canary, and nearly all of them contribute meaningfully to this in some way. So people who have never written a thing in their life are excited to, in this case, maybe write up a blog post on detecting Ryuk. And that's really cool. It's a way for people to share when they, you know, maybe don't think of themselves as a writer or think of somebody who can do that. So that's one way we do it, is through our blog. The second big component of our InfoSec community mission is our open source work. And as with our blog, it really all starts with that goal of improving security outcomes. And I think all of us would probably agree that what we've seen over the last 10, 15 years is that working together as a community and collaborating is really the key to driving the most effective progress in our industry. And so from our vendor side, we've seen that, you know, products that deliver the best outcomes are ones that have really well-defined and deployed APIs so that they integrate well into a security program. But we believe that if we, you know, want to go further with that, we really do have to pull together as a community and really take things to the next level. So if you think about the way an open source project kind of comes to life, one person generally has a problem that they want to solve, one person or one team. And then they find out that other people have the same problem, and they find ways to bring people in to work on it together. We firmly believe that a project or a tool that's worked on by a diverse set of contributors is going to be better than one that's worked on by a single contributor or a single team solving a single problem. Bringing people's problems together, in the case of Atomic Red Team, for the mission of helping people test themselves better, we've certainly seen be far more successful than if it was just us, you know, throwing tests down over and over. That's really where the magic lives for us in open source projects. So now I've kind of explained our view on open source, and we'll get to the subject of this talk, which is a project that we started in 2017 called Atomic Red Team. Quick show of hands, who here has heard of Atomic Red Team before coming to this talk? Okay, awesome, appreciate it, about half. That's great. So I'll give you a little bit of the history of kind of where it came from. Ultimately, as a vendor, we often found ourselves in a situation where people were rightly testing our detection capabilities. And the typical test went something like this. Spin up a virtual machine, go download 100 malware samples from wherever, VirusTotal or other, put them all on this one VM, run them all, call Red Canary and say, hey, why didn't you send me 100 alerts? And this sucked for a couple reasons. One, people thought our product didn't work, right? Two, people were testing us in a way that did not simulate the way that an actual attack would progress. And so to us, that spoke to a bigger problem in that teams didn't really know how best to test their defenses, whether it's prevention or detection and response or anything around those areas. And so at about the same time, MITRE ATT&CK was starting to gain a lot of steam. We also had this big library of tests internally that we always used to test ourselves, and started marrying that up with ATT&CK. And it became obvious that we wanted to combine those things into this library of tests that we could contribute to the community so that people could get better at testing their programs. One thing that was really important was that it needed to be fast and easy and have a really low barrier to entry. We wanted to make this so that you didn't have to know a lot about any of the execution frameworks or anything like that. You could execute these tests very simple and learn about what would happen in your environment. So those are kind of the principles behind it from a reason for doing it perspective. In terms of project requirements, these are the highest level requirements. The first is the most important, which is that, like I said, this testing needs to be very approachable. The barrier to entry and getting started needs to be super low so that more people will do it. That's kind of the way we think about it. We wanted to also make sure that the format and everything about it was easy to use for both humans, so you can walk in and just read the tests, but also for machines, so that as you get more mature, you can use execution frameworks and automate more of your testing, right? It needs to be both of them. Great documentation is the key to making sure that it's easy to come in and get started. And then last, we wanted to make sure there was enough community around it, enough maintainers, so that the project would survive, you know, whether Red Canary continued to be involved or not. We wanted to make sure that we could recruit a community, build a community that could maintain the project over time. So those were kind of the biggest requirements for the project. In terms of how we implemented it, the front door to Atomic Red Team is atomicredteam.io. This is a GitHub microsite. So Atomic Red Team, as with most open source projects, is a GitHub repo. In that repo, if you look around, you will find a directory for this microsite. So this front page is part of the project. And so if you were to wander into Atomic Red Team and try to get started and find something that didn't make sense to you, we would really appreciate it if you would write up a pull request and fix it for us, so that the next person who comes along doesn't have that same confusion. So that's part of the project. Anytime somebody wants to improve this, we love that, right? People tend to want to focus more on the tests, but this front door is kind of key to that mission of making sure it's approachable and easy to understand. Next thing in, it was really important, like we said, to have things that were human readable enough, but also worked for machines. So the format that we settled on was to use YAML. There was a big fight over this about what format to use. If you're not familiar with YAML, it's very similar to JSON in that it's key value based and supports things like lists and nested objects and things like that. And so this was a great format for us. The other really great thing about YAML is that very wide library support. So if you want to write an execution framework in Python or Ruby or PowerShell or whatever, broad support, shouldn't be any issue. So that's kind of where we started. It really hits that both human and relatively readable for humans here. Easy for machines, pretty easy for humans. Skipping charts. If you haven't ever seen YAML before, it's kind of what I described. One advantage that YAML has over, say, JSON is that comments are perfectly allowed. You can certainly put comments in JSON. Some libraries are okay with them, some aren't. YAML's totally cool with it. You can see how strings look. It gets rid of some of the extra syntax around quotes and curly braces and that kind of thing. Multi-line strings are easy, escaped strings. You can see at the bottom there's a list. And the list entries each start with a dash. And so you can nest objects in lists. So that's basically YAML 101. Really good format for doing this type of thing for all the reasons that I described. If we then zoom in on what does our schema within YAML look like, looks like something like this is the start of it. So each technique, and they are attack techniques, each technique has its own file. Within the atomics directory, which is just where all of the techniques are listed. And then within the file, first thing that's in there is what attack technique it maps to, and then the name for that technique. So in this case, this is T1007, system service discovery. And then moving down, you'll see the atomic test, which is the list of different ways that we can execute this technique. So if you were to find your way into this project, and my friend down here came up and asked me before the talk, what about Active Directory? Like, there's a lot of things around that. One approach to that would be to go to MITRE ATT&CK, find a technique that bypasses or steals credentials or compromises Active Directory in some way, come to Atomic Red Team, and look for that directory inside the atomics area. Go see if there's a test you can run. And assuming someone's gotten to it already, there will be some tests that you can really easily just run from your machine. So that's really what we're looking to do, is when you have something that you're worried about or you're scared of or you want to try to figure out how we can make sure we're safe, find the technique, come in here, there should be something for you to execute really quickly. And if there's not, that's a great place to interact with the community and find out, hey, what can we do to develop new tests and get some more coverage here. When you get down into the actual tests themselves, they look something like this. So we have a name for the test. Description can be free text, multi-line, in terms of what the test does, what platforms it works on. So in this case, this is a Windows test. You can pass arguments into these tests. So in this case, we've got a service name argument, which is, in this case, defaults to service host. Having good defaults is really important with this project, again, to make sure that nobody has to kind of figure this out on their own. I want to give you something that would work if you just went and ran it yourself. And then the executor is how to run the test. So in this case, we're saying that we're going to use a command prompt for this, and then it's these six lines that you would paste into the command prompt. interpolating that service host.exe into the templated service name field in each of the last three commands. So that's kind of it. On the surface, it doesn't seem like a lot. But once you end up building up a big library of this, they end up being very, very powerful. Because now the barrier to running a test to test for this technique goes from, you know, me finding a malware sample or something else, writing a script to try to figure out how to execute this test, or potentially buying a commercial product for it, to I come in here, I copy these lines, I throw them in a command prompt, and then I see what happens. Does it get stopped? Does it work? What visibility do I have in maybe my backend tools? Did I detect it? And that's kind of the goal. Next big piece of this is from the YAML files, we generate these really beautiful markdown documents. So even if you never got into the code directory or into the code in the repo, these are all out there. So you can go view them in GitHub. And if you're not going to automate it, if you're not going to download the repo, that's fine. You can just come in here, copy stuff off of here, and go execute it. These get generated every time somebody adds a new piece to the project, which is great. All right, so that's kind of the structure of the project, what it looks like. I'm going to now go into a little bit more detail about, let's say, the scenario described before. You run into a technique where, you know how to test it, but we don't have a test in Atomic Red Team for it already. How do you go about contributing? So this is not the way you should do it, but in general, it's a pretty straightforward, typical Git workflow. Starting with, go find the repo, fork it, clone it, bring it down to your local machine, and then the bottom line there is create a branch. Typically, we like to have the technique ID as the first part of the branch name, so we know what we're looking at. Create that branch. Next, create the test. So there's a helper script here. It's written in Ruby. If you don't want to install, don't have, and don't want to install Ruby on your machine, you certainly don't have to. We're big Rubyists at Red Canary, so that's why we tend to get into our projects in that way. All this does is create a templated out YAML file for the technique that you're bringing in. It's got a bunch of to-dos in it, so you can just immediately open it up, start filling in the contents of it. So that helper is out there for you. Next thing is for you to write the test. So here's sort of a popular one, using the register 32 bypass. You can see that in this case, there's a URL parameter that we're passing into this. That's a type URL. And you can also see that it's a link to a payload. So we'll talk about that in a second. But the point is that URL gets popped in there. You'd fill this out. That's the first part of the test. This executes on Windows only, runs in the command prompt. That's kind of it. For this to actually execute and be meaningful, we also need to add a payload. Obviously, we don't want any of the payloads that are checked into this project to be malicious. They should do simple things like open the calculator or notepad or something simple like that. That's kind of what we're looking for. So those get reviewed by the maintainers prior to anything getting merged up. So if you were running these things automatically, you can trust, hopefully, that we don't accidentally pull in something that's going to cause you harm. Once you've done that, there's a script here to validate it. The idea here is this validates syntax, so make sure that you've filled out all the right fields, everything's present so that this is a good and legitimate atomic test. Again, if you don't have Ruby on your machine, you don't need to worry about this. You can just push it up to your branch. We've got a build system on the back end that will run this anyway. So push it up, it'll do an automated build and spit back and tell you whether your test passed or failed. But you can run it locally before you push it up, and that'll tell you for sure that that you've defined everything correctly. Once you've done that, typical Git workflow, push it up to your branch, and then go to your GitHub account, your fork, follow the instructions to submit a pull request. That'll submit the pull request to our crew of maintainers. We within the last 6 months, have added the first maintainers that were outside of Red Canary, which is kind of a huge milestone for a project like this. Initially, it was folks on our team, but it is now officially community maintained by ourselves, but also a set of core contributors. Push that up, it gets reviewed. The maintainers will merge it in for you after reviewing the PR. They may also give you feedback and let you know, hey, you need to change this or tweak that before bringing it in. But you can see that whole workflow. Then that'll get merged in. Your name is immortalized on there as someone who's contributed to Atomic Red Team at that point. Like I said, once the PR is merged, the automated test will run. You can see the green past logo there. Once that happens, it'll automatically run the script to generate the markdown docs that we showed before. So it automatically goes there, shows up on the microsite, and that test is now available for everyone to use. If somebody had automated kind of pulling down and executing tests, it'll automatically get down into their workflow as well. So that's kind of how the project's structured and how it works. Next, I'm going to kind of talk about how we promote the community. And I will leave time at the end for questions. So I was going to ask if anybody had questions about how the project works, but we'll go ahead and hold them till the end and go from there. Just to speak some numbers about where this project has gone. So as of whenever I pulled these statistics, we had over 500 tests in the Atomic Red Team project, covering 158 of the 260-something attack techniques. So we've got a ways to go to get to continue to fill that in. Obviously, not all attack techniques are testable via this method, so it'll never be full coverage, but we've certainly grown a lot and seen that progression. More than 3,000 people are following the repo through stars on GitHub. There's been over 1,700 commits since that 2017 timeframe. Really, really proud of the fact that there's more than 80 people who've contributed to the project and do so on a regular basis. That's kind of an overwhelming number, to be honest, for us, just because it started with us just as a silly idea. So to have more than 80 people who are now actively participating in the community contributing to the project is awesome. And then we have more than 1,300 people in a Slack workspace, which I'll talk about in a second. But that's some of the numbers about what's happened since 2017 with this project. So to talk a little bit more about kind of how we got there, how we got to those metrics, talk a little bit how we promote the project. A lot of, as you probably know, a lot of open source projects get started and don't really get much participation outside of the original contributors. Which usually leads to them kind of stalling out. The original group kind of gets bored of it or moves on to something and stops. So we knew we needed to make sure and build out a contributor collaborator basis beyond just ourselves to keep it moving. So we spent a lot of time actually with some of the maintainers of the OS query project, which has been a really successful open source project in security, and tried to figure out what were the things that they did that really helped that project gain traction. Outside of just doing a ton of work themselves. And this is one of the things they recommended. So we spun up a Slack workspace where people can communicate about whatever. Like I said, if you come in there and posted, hey, I'm trying to test technique, blah, 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 I don't see it in the Atomic Red Team repo, you will get a lot of engagement from people who are motivated to help you build out that test or build it out for you or talk about why it's not possible. And maybe alternate ways to test it, which is great. This is open to everybody, so please feel free to jump in there. It's a great community with a lot of folks really active and wanting to help you. Another thing that we've kind of contributed is gear. So this shirt, the logo, we had our creative team build that, make these shirts, take them to conferences, try to get the word out. And spread them around. We also, and this is again something we picked up from the OS query team, people are very motivated by shirts and stickers, believe it or not. And so, Red Canary already had a pretty strong shirt game, and so we brought it to this problem. And so anytime somebody contributes their first test, we're gonna reach out to them and say, hey, we wanna drop you a package, we'll send them a shirt, send them stickers. So good way to reward people and get that spreading a little bit, and people reach out to us and say, hey, how do we get one of these shirts? And it's an easy answer. It's go write some tests and contribute, and we'll happily send you some. But that's, again, another example of something that the Red Canary corporate entity puts behind this project, is contributing gear to folks who participate. The last thing to mention in terms of how we promote the project, we do a thing about once a month called Atomic Friday. This is a webinar produced by the Red Canary internal team, speaking about some subject related to testing. So maybe a specific type of detection or a way of automating or you name it. But they've been great. We've been able to attract audiences of, you know, thousands of people that come on there. And sometimes it's the people who've already interacted with the community, but a lot of times it is new voices and new folks who want to join and learn more about the project. And they're a lot of fun. So I would recommend if you're curious about the project, definitely seek the next one of these out. There's also recordings and blog posts around the ones that we've done previously out there in Red Canary land. So I would suggest kind of get out there and see what's available. And the last thing I wanted to mention is that kind of an important thing about with open source projects is try to avoid them getting bloated and getting too big. And you know, depending on who the maintainers are, sometimes they are more or less comfortable with that approach. So one thing we wanted to set out to do is to say, look, there's a ton of amazing things you can do around this set of tests. We don't want Atomic Red Team as a project itself to try to solve everything, right? And so these two are examples of projects that kind of spawned out of work on Atomic Red Team. Chain Reactor is a kind of a cool tool that we put out there. That's the idea is to chain together both atomic tests, but also other tests specific to Linux environments and Linux detection testing. So if your problem you're trying to solve is how do I do good tests on my Linux detection capabilities, I would recommend go check out Chain Reactor. It's really neat. And then the second, the Invoke Atomic Red Team project actually was part of the Atomic Red Team project. And within the last couple weeks, it kind of gained enough momentum and became a big enough thing on its own that the decision was made by the maintainers to spin it out into its own project. So it now has a slightly different set of maintainers focused specifically on that project, which is all about, it's a PowerShell framework to make it easy to execute Atomic Red Team tests. So that's a really cool project as well. And if you are kind of trying to take that next step and not just run things in a command prompt by hand, but you want to actually start invoking them a little bit more automatically, that project is cool and a good place to start there as well. So I'll put this up there and then leave this chart up there while taking questions. If you do want to join the Atomic Red Team community and participate, these would be the links I would send you to. You can certainly start at the Red Canary website at Atomic Red Team, go join the Slack community. Hilariously, I didn't put atomicredteam.io up here, so that hopefully you took a picture of that one previously. That would actually be the place I'd start. A lot of great resources out there, and like I said, the Slack community is full of people who would love to interact and help you learn what first steps to take. That's all the content I have. I think my voice almost survived, so I will stick around and take questions if anybody would like the microphones here. Or I'll go get hot tea. Yeah, absolutely.
So it's adversary emulation. Mm-hmm. Is there any way you've seen the comments where it would like if you're looking to say, okay, well, this is a threat group that I'm focusing on, I'm curious what techniques they would use.
Sure.
Yeah,
so the question for the broader audience, this is described as an adversary emulation tool, but didn't see a lot of mapping to specific adversaries or adversary groups, kind of the question. That's correct, and we don't attempt to do that inside of Atomic Red Team. That our scope is MITRE ATT&CK has defined the techniques, and we're providing tools and tests to be able to execute those techniques. On the MITRE ATT&CK side, there is more of that mapping to what adversary groups and what different types of malware and attacks like to use different techniques. So if you're looking for that information, you would kind of start there. And then again, you know, if you wanted to simulate, you know, APT32 or whatever, you might start there and then make your way over to Atomic Red Team to see if you if there's a test that would do that emulation. Does that make sense?
Sure.
Great. Katie, was that the right answer? Okay, good. It's always nervous doing a talk that has anything to do with MITRE ATT&CK when the queen of MITRE ATT&CK is in the building. So anyway, sorry to call you out, Katie. Thank you.
If you have, how do you have a means to track your progress? So I know, I think on one of your sites, you allude to a spreadsheet that someone had built. Is that the best method, best known method presently, or is there other means to track your progress as you test and get some metrics on your progress?
Yeah, good question. Yeah, in terms of metrics on progress, we don't currently have anything inside of the Atomic Red Team project that supports that use case. One method that folks have been using is MITRE ATT&CK has the attack navigator, if you're familiar with that. So the way that works is you're able to define what they call layers and use this tool to visualize where you have coverage or where you are testing. So that's a pretty popular way to do it, is to do some testing and then use your results, whatever that might be, whether you're looking for visibility or detection or prevention, and put that into an attack navigator layer that you could then use to visualize and see, hey, you know, where haven't we tested and maybe we want to expand for the next time. And theoretically, like, progress that over time. So you could go to the board or whatever and say, here's the snapshot from 6 months ago, here's our snapshot today, and more things are green, right?
Yeah. Does that navigator, I'm not that familiar with it, somewhat, but does that navigator allow you to tie your controls to those so you can kind of gauge your maturity of the particular control?
It does, absolutely. Yeah, you can create effectively a layer for anything. So if you wanted to have one layer that says, here's our controls mapped to attack techniques, and then here's our test results mapped to attack techniques, and then you can kind of toggle on and off those layers to see kind of where they overlap and where they don't.
Great. Thank you.
Yeah, for sure. Great questions. Anything else?
Yeah, so I had a question about how the execution framework relates to Caldera. Like, is it possible to make, you know, have Caldera run atomic tests, or are they two completely separate things?
Yeah, good question. So Caldera is a execution framework from MITRE. There are ways to run atomic tests with Caldera and kind of vice versa. I'm not super familiar with this, so Katie's eyes are burning a hole in me right now. But yes, and I think I'm not an expert on that, but I think that'd be a great question to go into the Slack community and just ask, and there may be someone who has a pre-built answer for how to go do it. Sorry, I couldn't be more helpful.
Today, this morning, I came across Tanium, an endpoint security company, and they told me they were using Red Canary. Is there a formal collaboration between the two of you, or are they just using your open source implementation?
So it was an endpoint security company?
Yes.
What was their name?
Tanium.
Tanium. That's a good question. We don't currently, on the vendor side of the house, we don't currently support Tanium. So anything that they would be doing with us today would be, you know, them making use of this open source project with their tooling.
All right, thank you.
But I can ask them.
Yeah.
Great, thanks. All right, what else? All right, well, I'm done a little early, so thanks everybody for attending. I really appreciate it. Have a great day.